Thank you. There is, of course, one other lecture series. Jeremy was mentioning, or Dr. Barrier was mentioning, the three lecture series hosted by the graduate department. There's also a lecture series hosted by the library and the COIL Colloquium. And this year, D.A. Carson is coming, is that right? And that'll be in about 2 months, April timeframe. But the graduate research lecture is the one we're doing right now, and this gives us an opportunity to host a recent graduate in a PhD program who is in the Churches of Christ. And so, as Jeremy mentioned, we've had this perhaps five or six times, and are pleased this year to have Lance Hawley with us. Dr. Hawley graduated recently from University of Wisconsin at Madison, where he did a PhD in Hebrew Bible and focused on the book of Job, I take it, from the theme of the lectures today. And so he has been teaching at Harding in Memphis, the Harding School of Theology, for this is his second year doing that. And he has a lot of experience in church work. In fact, he moved to Wisconsin, where he's from. He grew up in Wisconsin. He moved back to Wisconsin to plant churches there. And while he was there, he enrolled in the PhD program. So his purpose of going back to Wisconsin was not actually to get a PhD, but to plant churches. And so we're pleased to be able to have him, somebody with his experience, his love for the church, and his experience in scholarship as well. The theme that he'll be talking about today in both lectures is the book of Job. His first lecture is titled The Rhetoric of Condemnation in the Jobin Dialogue. And so he'll be talking about that this morning at this time, and then at 1 o'clock he will give another lecture. He'll also be doing our chapel for us this morning as well. So I'll turn it over to Lance after Nathan leads us in a prayer.
Let's pray together. Our Father, we thank you for another day in your world. We thank you for a morning where we can come together and be together as community and think about you, learn about you, and reflect on your word and reflect on our own lives in relation to it. We thank you so much for Lance and for his work and his study and all that he's done to prepare himself to be able to open your word in new ways for us today. We thank you for the hope that you give to each one of us, the place we are where we know we're yours, and we look for ways to reflect and emulate you throughout each step of our life. Please continue to be with us and guide us as we look for new and better ways to be like you and walk in the steps of your Son, who came to this earth and lived and died, and was raised, and ascended to be with you. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning. Thank you to the faculty here at Heritage for inviting me to be with you. And this is my first time. I've been in Alabama before, but barely. So this is my real first experience, I think, here. If you want to just go ahead and open your Bibles to Job, we're going to spend a lot of time and looking at texts. And what I'm planning to do for this morning, and let me make sure I stop at the right time. So, what time should that be?
Around 9:50.
Okay. Yeah. So we want to reserve a few minutes that builds in a few minutes for questions.
Right.
Okay. So. I'll talk for a little bit, but I'm definitely interested in hearing your reflections. You know, the book of Job is one that is at once raw with emotion and connects with people. whether they're people familiar with the bigger narrative of God and his people or not, because it connects because it's about suffering and the human experience. But it's also a book that's probably written to an elite readership, so it's got this kind of two poles where it's a very difficult book and almost impenetrable book sometimes, and yet one that people care deeply about and resonate with. So I'm eager to hear what your reflections on it and what I have to say. My experience with the Book of Job is an early one in college, just reading it all at once. And I heartily recommend that you take 4 hours some point in your life and read the Book of Job all at once. In fact, when I teach Job and I have the opportunity to assign readings, that's one of the assignments, is to read it, and they journal through it as they read it all, because you have to read the whole thing to get the point of the book, and even then it's sometimes difficult to know what the point of the book is. Some people teach Job from out of their experience of suffering, and I have a lot of respect for those readings. I personally am somebody who sits in the place of the friends more than I do with Job, I feel like, anyway, as far as somebody who has the opportunity to counsel or to walk with or to interact with people who have undergone trauma than somebody who has experienced it. I mean, we all suffer. Suffering is suffering, whether it's Job's, you know, enormous suffering or the kind of the everyday experiences of people. I teach this book and I think about this book primarily within the framework of wisdom literature, so along with Proverbs and Ecclesiastes. A book that is meant to teach principles of wisdom, and but also connects very intimately with the reality of trauma and suffering. So I want to do a little bit of introduction. This afternoon, we're going to go to a question of what does Yahweh have to say? What does God have to say? You know, when God talks back finally in the book. And it takes a long time to get there, right? It's not until chapter 38. So that's an intriguing question, you know, what's within the content of his message. But this morning, primarily looking at the dialogue, so chapters 3, really through 31. We won't talk, unless you really are eager to talk about Elihu after, we can do that in questions time. Looking at how Job and his companions talk to each other, and this is the major bulk of my dissertation work. It is, which I'll talk a little briefly about, but I also kind of just want to give you an overflow of one of the observations I made as I was working through the book in close reading. Edwin Good, somebody who writes or has written on the Book of Job, and his commentary on, there's this passage in chapter 30, 1 through 8, and there's nothing so unusual about this except that it's difficult. And this is the way he describes Job, okay? So he says, the text, talking about chapter 30, 1 through 8, has gone kaleidoscopic again, opening on several possibilities, not all of which cohere logically with the others. If the reader, weary of contradictions and complexities, cries out in frustration, "Just tell me what it means," I can say only that the Book of Job means is often confusing and almost always multiple. If it were not so, Job would not be such an exhilarating book. Yet exhilaration always verges on hyperventilation. So, I mean, it's a very difficult book. And most people don't read beyond the first two chapters in the prologue, you know, the narrative portions. That's kind of the not just current readership, but historical readership has not dealt very much with the difficulties of the dialogue. It's poetry, it's hard to know what they're talking about, and that was what was intriguing to me. So that's what we're going to be focusing on this morning. There are several issues that the book addresses, issues of divine testing, God testing Job, disinterested piety. In chapter 1, verse 9, the question is, does Job serve God for no benefit? Does he love God? Does he honor God for the benefits? And that's something that's tested throughout the book. Retributive justice, you know, does God pay people, give people what they deserve, innocent or wicked? Innocent suffering then relates to that. These are the usual suspects when it comes to the topics of the books or the meaning of the book. However, there are other subjects like friendship, social status, and the value of speech that are no less meaningful. And this latter one, the value of speech, is what I have focused on in my research and I want to share with you a little bit about. The way that I got into the dialogue was through studying metaphors. And rather than giving a lecture on metaphor, which probably you're maybe intrigued by, but don't care as deeply about, I want to kind of just get over this fast. But Carol Newsom, a scholar at Emory, who's written some on Job, said something in her commentary. She said that that Job and his friends struggle over metaphors. So it was a stepping off place for me. So what does it mean that they're not dialoguing logically? It's not a logical debate where they're picking up each other's points and responding very directly. So in fact, some scholars have said one speech doesn't relate to the other at all. But I think they do, and what they do is talk in tropes and metaphors and poetic imagery. That does sort of respond to the others, but she doesn't explain what struggling over metaphors means so much. So I used, in my research, conceptual metaphor theory, which I'm not going to talk about, to describe what's going on kind of in the brain when somebody speaks a metaphor, and getting at the more cognitive or conceptual level of the book, and specifically talking about metaphor competition. So a couple of quick examples of what metaphor competition is, and we will come back to this this afternoon. Within the book, for example, Bildad. So Job has three friends, Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar, and they each take turns speaking with Job. Eliphaz speaks first in chapter 4, and Bildad speaks first in chapter 8, his first speech. And in chapter 8, verse 19, is at the end of a poetic trope about trees. So here, Bildad is talking about trees, and his whole point is that, you know, a tree, there are trees that are wicked, or there are symbols for the wicked, there are trees that are symbols for the righteous, and for the righteous, even if they're cut down to the stump, they can re-sprout again, right? So there's hope. It's an image of hope for Job. And Job, in chapter 14, seems to be responding to this image with a tree image of his own, and he says, yeah, there's hope for a tree, and this is, you know, whether they're biologists or not, they aren't, but they're, you know, you can still have a root sprout up. Yeah, that, but I'm a person. You know, sort of cutting the legs out, that metaphor that people are trees doesn't work. So he cuts the legs out from the metaphor and he says, I'm human, I die, and there's no resprouting. Job's not a believer in the resurrection, although he toys with it at one point. You can do this kind of back and forth, whether you could look at all the plant imagery in the book of Job and see how they're struggling over metaphors, or looking at how they talk about tense, or as I did, looking at metaphors for speech and then metaphors for animals. I love animals, and there's a lot of wild animal imagery, and God himself talks a lot about animals when he responds to Job, so this is why I was gravitating toward those. So kind of keep that, my work is mostly about metaphor competition in the book of Job. And what I found when I traced how the friends and Job are talking about talking, how they're evaluating each other's speeches, and the metaphors they were using for that, is that they both speak about condemnation. So this is my rhetoric for condemnation, okay? This is come up with a great title, and then you find the content to fit it. So what I want to do first is look at how Job's friends condemn or maybe don't condemn Job, and then look at what Job says kind of in response, or, you know, does he use the same kind of language? The issue of speech is dominant, I think, undervalued within the book of Job. Even at the very end of the prologue, where the narrator is telling us, in chapter 2, verse 10, in all this, Job didn't sin with his lips. So what we're, I think it's a, not, it's, it, there is a heart issue earlier. You know, Job is the quintessential righteous man, inside and out, but the test of what's inside is what somebody speaks. And so will Job curse God is a question then that drives the narrative. And so far, of course, in the prologue and in the narrative portion, no, he doesn't curse God. But then when he starts speaking in chapter 3, the very first thing that he says is a curse, not against God, but against something that God has made, namely the day that he was born. So as a reader of the book, I think you should be asking, is Job cursing God? Is he sinning against God? And it is historically a question that people have wrestled with, and there aren't obvious answers, but the friends certainly give their opinion about answering that question. Maybe not so affirmatively as maybe they get depicted as, but certainly condemning Job to a certain degree. So let's turn first to chapter 4. Job in chapter 3 has, as I said, cursed the day of his birth. Wish he was never born. I wish I would die. And Job's hope is to die. Perhaps that's why he's so upset. There's these 7 days of silence, and he hasn't died. And he just wants God to take his life. He doesn't understand why God is torturing him like this by keeping him alive. Now Eliphaz, then, is only compelled to speak after Job has spoken. And I think something that Job said in chapter 3 compels Eliphaz to respond. So in these first 11 verses, we get some of a hint to what we see in the majority of the friend's speeches. So he asks, if one ventures a word with you, will you be offended? But then who can restrain words? And the image here is sort of like covering a mouth. And there's a wisdom principle that you don't talk, right, unless you have something good to say or wise to say. This is a principle that we still teach, I think, I hope. So it's exhibited in chapter 10, verse 19 of Proverbs, he who restrains his lips is wise, and that's just one example of many. Although there is an appropriate time to speak, in the same chapter, in verses 10 through 11, the one who rebukes boldly makes peace. The mouth of the righteous is a fountain of life. So Job and his friends are sages. They're teachers. They're not just comforters. And maybe that should be more comforter than teacher. But Eliphaz feels compelled to rebuke Job for what he's said, because Job is not speaking like Job usually does in chapter 3. And so he says, I can't hold it back anymore. I can't restrain this word. And so he decides this is an appropriate time to speak in order to make peace, to lay aside the principle of restraining speech. And he's framing it in a way that he can't help it. He must speak. And then he reminds Job of what his past. So this is one thing we'll see, and you would see in many of these speeches. See, you, Job, have instructed many. You have strengthened the weak hands. Your words have supported those who are stumbling. And you have made firm feeble knees. So Job himself has been one who has rebuked and taught and strengthened with his own speech. But now it's come to you, and you are impatient. It touches you, and you're dismayed. Isn't your fear of God your confidence, and the integrity of your ways your hope? The friends are often characterized as just simply condemning Job, you know, and kind of searching for some secret sin that caused his suffering. But if you read their speeches closely, they kind of get there. They don't start there. In fact, they have hope for Job, for his restoration. And they're seeking to remind Job of who he is, his own character. Like, I mean, the gist of much of their speeches is, Job, this isn't you, right? You don't talk like this, you know, and trying to remind him of his past and this fear of God that he has and the integrity that he has. And this is a reason to hope. So they will, when they're talking to Job, they will say, you should have hope because you're a man of integrity. And then this next step is to talk about the wicked in very general ways. Not to say Job is wicked, but to describe what wicked people are like. So This is what Eliphaz does in 7 through 11. And he describes them with things like, think now, whoever that was innocent ever perished. By the way, Job hasn't perished. So a way of saying, you know, you have innocence, or were cut off, who were upright were cut off. As I have seen, those who plow iniquity sow trouble and reap the same. But by the breath of God they perish, and by the blast of his anger they are consumed. And then he goes on with this sort of analogy, an animal analogy. So this is where I make my make kind of camp out a little bit in 10 through 11, although we'll look at this later. He talks about lions. He just starts, you know, like, think about the lion. The roar of the lion, the voice of the fierce lion, the teeth of the young lions are broken. There's like 7 different Hebrew words for lion in these 2 verses. The strong lion perishes for lack of prey, and the whelps of the lioness are scattered. So what's the point of Eliphaz talking about lions but to say that this is how wicked people are treated? The lions are a regular symbol for wickedness. They're predation on innocent prey. It mirrors the actions of the wicked. And the point is, God punishes the wicked. He's not necessarily saying, Job, you're wicked. He's saying, you aren't wicked, at least at this point. But there's some subtle clues that, you know, relate to what Job has said in chapter 3, that it says you're kind of talking like a wicked person. You're placing yourself, even Job in at the end of 3, he uses the word roar. The NRSV that I'm reading doesn't have it in here, but in verse 24, my sighing comes like my bread, or before my bread, and my groanings, that's the word roarings, are poured out like water. Now that doesn't mean that Job is comparing himself to a lion, but Eliphaz seems to be picking up on that and says, well, you're using the language of the wicked. So this is kind of their second argument, and this is what we see repeated over and over. And the friends, here's kind of the big point here, that the friends are accusing Job of misspeaking. In ways that don't fit with like the character of a righteous person. So Bildad in chapter 8, and we're skipping Job's talk or language for now. And I just want to kind of quickly get ready to flip through some stuff. But in chapter 8, verse 2, he questions Job about, and he even characterizes his speech as a great wind. Okay, so this is picking up on Job chapter 6. Job just said, you know, do you intend to rebuke words or consider words of one who despairs as wind? Are you treating my speech like wind? And Bildad essentially will say, yeah. But not this ephemeral, insubstantive type of, it's not just that Job is speaking meaningless things, but a great wind, this phrase is always associated with destruction. Your words are self-destructive. So a sort of a condemnation, pointing to Job and saying, you know, you're running yourself into the ground with the way you're talking. He goes on in this chapter with tropes of the wicked, just like Eliphaz did. Well, not, and even saying in verse 13, the hope of the godless will perish. So remember, Job has been saying, I don't have any hope. You know, my hope is just to die. And the friends will say, that's the hope that the wicked have. There's still a kind of a hope that they're trying to give him. They're saying, you know, pray to God, you know, submit yourself to him, and he'll restore you. But Job doesn't find any integrity in that. And he finds it to be dishonest and an affront to God himself. Zophar, in his speech in chapter 11, verses 2 through 3, and a lot of the language where they evaluate speeches at the beginning of the speeches, should a multitude of words go unanswered, and should one full of talk be vindicated? Or he calls him, the actual phrase is that he's a man of lips. You know, you just keep talking. You're a man of lips. Should this kind of person be acquitted? Will your loose talk silence men? You've mocked, and none has put you to shame. And then verse 4 is the content. They're saying Job is claiming that he's innocent, and he's just going on and on about that, and at once he's speaking self-condemnation. So this type of thing continues, but I want to focus maybe before we turn to Job himself on chapter 15. So turn over to the beginning of 15. This is Eliphaz's second speech, where he asks him, we have another speech is wind metaphor, and he says, should the wise, or I'll read, will a wise man answer windy knowledge or fill his belly with the east wind? So we had Bildad calling it a mighty wind. Here the east wind is this like scorching hot desert type of wind. Should he argue in useless words or words that do not profit? Verse 5, for your transgression teaches your mouth, and you choose the language of the crafty. And this is a really important verse for our topic. Your mouth condemns you, not me. Your lips testify against you. So basically, this is a sort of an unexplored argument. That the what Job's friends are really criticizing Job for is the way that he's talking in the dialogue. And they're, at least at this point, the Eliphaz's third speech, he really does start sort of blanket accusation that he's taken advantage of the widow and the orphan. And he's reciting a list of unjust acts. But prior to this, it's mostly about, their criticism is mostly about how Job is talking in the book and not looking, searching for the secret sin that caused his suffering. They just simply see that as rebuke, divine rebuke. And Bildad will speak about him tearing himself in anger. So far, every one of the speeches talks about speech itself. So their friends rebuke Job for two themes in his speech. One, the insistence that he's innocent, that he's treated unjustly, and second, and somewhat related, they rebuke him for this dangerous speech. His vitriolic speech is self-condemning. So it's not the friends condemning, but his self-condemnation. So what does Job have to say about all of this? You would think that he might protest, and yet he agrees in large part. And this is, Job kind of knows what he is doing. There are several things that he says to his friends. He says, you know, I'll be silent if you teach me. That's in chapter 6. But he considers this kind of blind submission that they're encouraging to be false confession. In chapter 6 there in verse 23, he says, oh, that my vexation, and this word vexation, in chapter 5, Eliphaz said, surely vexation kills a fool. So, and then he says, but if you knew my vexation, he doesn't necessarily disagree with Eliphaz, but he says, oh, that my vexation were weighed, and my calamity would be set with it on the balances, for then it would weigh more than the sand of the seas. This is why I speak my words rashly. So he admits, like, yeah, I'm speaking rashly. I'm not speaking as a wise person here. I'm speaking as a sufferer. Without restraint, he's not trying to defend his ways as rational. In chapter 7, in the same speech, this is the latter part of it, verse 11, I also, that's in addition to Eliphaz, won't restrain my mouth. Let me speak in the distress of my spirit. Let me complain in the bitterness of my soul. In chapter 9, Bildad speaks in chapter 8, in chapter 9, Job comes back, verse 20 through 22, even if I'm righteous, so even if I'm righteous internally, my mouth will condemn me. If I'm blameless, it declares me crooked. This is what Eliphaz, I think, picks up on in chapter 15 and says, yeah, that's what I'm saying, right? It's just like, your own mouth condemns you, not me, and Job has already said it himself. In verse 21, I am blameless. I don't know myself. I despise my life. It's all the same. Therefore, I speak blameless and the wicked will bring to an end. So I'm just going to go for it. I have this story that in my mind relates well to what Job is sort of cognitively going through in this. And I don't know if you have a story kind of like this, but in my childhood, I used to ride the bus to school. And I wasn't always, this is a confession, okay? So he wasn't always a straight and narrow, great kid. But I was pretty quiet, but in this particular bus driver, nobody liked. I feel so bad for the bus drivers now. But anyway, she was very strict, and you couldn't talk, couldn't do anything, and we decided to form a coup and start a party, essentially a wrestling match on the bus. And that I wasn't my decision, but I was like, okay, you know. Anyway, we all got in trouble for it. At one point, I was sitting up front in the bus, and she was giving it to a bunch of other people, and I decided, I couldn't restrain words, okay? So I just got up, and I started, I don't remember what I was saying, but probably something really foolish and dumb. And as I was speaking to her, I was like, I know I'm going to pay for this. You know, and I started crying because I knew, but I was kind of out of my mind. And I feel like this is how Job is, maybe more justifiably, where he knows what he's doing. He knows that he's irrational, or he sounds irrational. But it's ultimately righteous speech because what he's speaking is honest. This is how I feel. And one of the lessons I think the book of Job speaks to us is that God cares a lot about honesty, honest speech. So I'm not saying that to justify my own irrational speech on the bus, but I have this feeling of being overwhelmed and knowing you're going to pay for it. I think Job expects that he's going to die, essentially, because of the way that he's talking. He agrees with the friends that people shouldn't talk like this, but he decides to do it anyway. This in chapter 10, the first two verses of the second half of his speech, he says, "My soul, my life is disgusted with my life. My soul is disgusted with my life." Then he says, "I will let loose my complaint upon myself. I will speak in the bitterness of my soul. I will say to God, do not condemn me. Teach me about why you contend with me." So he does still have this, you know, don't condemn me, teach me something. And yet this phrase that he will let loose, he will sort of leave his complaint out there with the understanding that it will come back upon him. He's going to throw caution to the wind. In chapter 13, when speaking to the friends, verse 13 and 15, "Be silent from me, and I will speak, and let whatever come over me come over me. So come what may. I will take my flesh in my teeth, and I will lift my life in my hand." Both of these are images. The second one is more reasonable. It's associated with risk. The first one is unusual, that he would take this is an animal metaphor for basically taking his own flesh in his own teeth. So he's preying upon himself. And I think there might even be some relation I could go either way on this, but the mouth is at play here, right? So what he's saying realizes it has consequences. And then we get to 15. This is a more famous verse in the book of Job, chapter 13, verse 15. Traditionally translated, "Though he slays me, I will wait for him, I will hope in him," or something. And that's, I don't think that's a good translation. It's based on I'll just say it. If you don't understand it, that's okay. But a Masoretic way of formulating the word low. So they're reading it not or to him. The better way of translating this that fits within the context of Job, I think, is, "Look, he will kill me. I won't wait." And later, this word for waiting in chapter 29 is in reference to speaking. "I'm not going to wait to speak. So I'm not going to hold back my words. He will kill me, or he may kill me. I will argue my ways to his face." That's in line with the Septuagint, the Greek translation. So it kind of pulls the rug out from that famous verse in Job, but it really fits better with the regular content of what he's saying. He's like, I know I might die for this, but I'm going to keep on speaking. So Job essentially agrees with the friends about the risky nature of his speech, but he disagrees about the certainty of his condemnation. And he does slowly reconstruct a vision for how he might have a different kind of conversation with God. And so in several of his speeches, he goes from a hope in dying to a hope for a face-to-face with God. You know, if God could just look at me for what this is, then he would see that there's been some kind of injustice. So he grabs on to a legal metaphor for taking God to court, where he, you know, sometimes he talks about a mediator or a witness or these types of things, but essentially he wants a different posturing. So in chapter 13, he talks about this, whereas he describes in verse 21 as if God is like kind of oppressing him with his hand, sort of pushing him down here and looking the other way. And what Job wants is for God to look at him in the face and no longer be oppressing him with his hand. But if somehow that could happen, then Job feels certain that God would see the injustice of what's happened in his life. You know, so there's this new kind of dialogue that's imagined, but he doesn't seem to have much hope in it. In the very end, in chapter 29 through 31, he really lays out his full case. Here's my testimony. This is how life was. This is how life is now. And here, and he even signs the document, sort of to his legal plea. So he gravitates onto this, and his friends have big problems with that. It's like, you can't take God to court. And essentially, they're right. And yet, God does not kill him for what he's saying. Probably a surprise to everyone, it seems like, in the book. So they're really wrestling with this in the way that they're, the tropes that they're using. I will just, let's see. I've kind of skipped over a few things in order to save us some time. What we're going to do in the, part of what I've skipped over is just introducing the book as a whole. So if you have questions about just the prologue even, how the book is set up, I'm happy to entertain those in our discussion. But my major point is to point out that speech is a really important theme in the book of Job. That's undervalued in scholarship in general. That people don't realize that what comes out of Job's mouth is the witness against him in Job's mind and in the view of the friends. And eventually they give up on him and do fully categorize him as among the wicked. But that's not on the basis of him having suffered what he does in the beginning of the book, the loss of his family and possessions and household. It's more on the basis of what he is saying within the book. This isn't just lament. You know, lament, how long, O Lord, crying out to God, bringing attention to the injustices that people experience. But it's what's different in this than lament is that God has caused it. And we know as readers that God has caused it. Like, there's an injustice here, and God is ultimately responsible for the injustice. Job never knows that. He never finds out in the end that it was a test. He is a person who, and his friends never know that. I mean, in a way, he is affirmed in chapter 42. You kind of have to go to the end of the book. In chapter 42, verse 7, Job, or God, is talking to Eliphaz, and he says, "You have not spoken rightly about me as my servant Job has." So there's something that Job has said that's correct and right, that the friends have not. And I think that must be his maintaining of his integrity, his speaking honestly. There's also something that's wrong. In chapter 38, verse 2, when God starts speaking, notice the theme of speech even in this verse, that, you know, he asks Job, "Who is this who's darkened counsel with words without knowledge?" So with words, he has darkened God's design, God's plan. And Job has been more than edgy. You know, Eliphaz will give him a doxology to speak before God. And Job, that's in chapter 5. In chapter 9, Job, you know, gives a mock doxology of how God turns the light into darkness. And he basically brings the whole world down with him. And I think there is something that Job says that's incorrect, at least theologically errant, wrong. He was wrong about God. And yet he is right to take the risk in order to speak, even if it's the risk that God might punish him even more for what he says, but it's honest, and God ultimately affirms that decision. So he is not condemned in the book, even though that he and his friends sort of recognize the condemnation that comes through his speech. So I'll pause there and let's have a little discussion. Your questions are really intriguing to me. If you want to pick up on any of these verses or just talk about the book of Job some more. Great. Yeah.
And Joel Kelly is amazing. Speak, we don't know anybody else is there.
Yeah.
And then so much in the legal metaphor, he's engaging God.
Mm-hmm.
In 12, too, that funny passage, no doubt you are the people, when you die, wisdom will not die.
Yeah, right.
And so how much is that, what do you think about that? I mean, speak beyond the freedom, hot shots go occasionally.
Yeah. They do, especially at the beginning of their speeches, they sort of subtly acknowledge. I mean, the friends always talk to Job, right? The friends never talk to God. In fact, some have even argued that in chapter 42, verse 7, I mean, the preposition is actually to. So you could translate it as, you have not spoken to me, rightly to me, as my servant Job has. So maybe one of the problems with the friends is that they haven't prayed to God on behalf of Job, as Job then will do for his friends later. And Job will address his friends, but he sort of flip-flops. Much of his address is toward God. So, yeah, I mean, he's the gist of what he's saying to his friends is, you're not saying anything that I don't know. Yeah, I even know that my words are rash. And, you know, as far as this topic, but also other topics, you know, the wisdom, surely wisdom will die with you. That's got to be, you know, ironic, sort of taunting them. And they're frustrated with that as well. But then Job will usually turn his attention to God, to addressing the injustices at God's hand.
He's addressing God, he's tolerating the friends.
Yeah, he does tolerate the friends, and he does criticize them for the way that they're treating him. There's one point where he's saying, you know, if I was in your place, then I think this is chapter 15. I could use words, to mourn with you. Let's see. I don't like the translation, the NRSV. No, that's Eliphaz's speech, where he'll would say, I would comfort you better than you are doing to me, essentially. You know, and there's no good way to comfort Job except through silence. That's ultimately what Job says, silence would be your wisdom. But they feel compelled because their job is to rebuke, right? So to set things right, they have to keep on speaking. And that's why this kind of dialogue just drones on, right? Keep going on and on. That's actually, I think, as you read it all at once sometime, you should get tired with the characters. You get tired of the dialogue going round and round. There's this rhetorical effect of the book. It wants you to feel a little bit of the frustration of the characters themselves. Good question. Other questions or comments?
So,
for Gallagher.
I'm just trying to get it straight. One of the things you're suggesting is that we often characterize the friends as holding this humanistic theology.
Yeah.
Where if Job is suffering, therefore he must have sinned. He must be because of his suffering. And you're suggesting that's not what they're thinking.
Right.
That they, when they're sitting with him for 7 days, they don't necessarily already think he's a sinner, but it's through the process of the dialogue that they come to this.
Yeah.
It's not the fact that you're suffering that we know that you're a sinner, it's because of your words that are coming out of your mouth
right. That
condemn you.
Yeah, I do think everybody in the book, and even I will argue that God sort of still maintains some system of retributive justice, like people get what they deserve generally. And the friends definitely associate his suffering with rebuke for sin. And Job would even confess, I've sinned. I mean, in spite of what God says about him in the beginning, that he's, you know, pretty much perfect, he would say, in my sin, I have sinned, but what I'm experiencing, it doesn't balance with the sin I've had. So I think that concept, like the deuteronomistic idea of people getting what they deserve, righteous and wicked, are certainly, that's part of the fabric of the wisdom mindset, and everybody in the book, I think, agrees with that. It's just that when they don't come to the position of full condemnation of Job, until they see it basically as rebuke, as Elihu does too, as a way of God sort of, you know, punishing him in order to restore him. Eventually, though, they get to just, you know, spewing accusations against him, and that's on the basis of what he's saying. And so I think they do come to group him among the wicked, like fully categorize him there, not on the basis of his early suffering, but on the way that he's talking. So I don't think it's a total skewing of the kind of the retributive justice mindset. But yeah, there's something in the content of what he's saying that leads them to a fuller realization of that.
In the beginning, though, when God says that Job is perfect, that's all of that.
Yeah.
Just like with David's heart being perfect.
Mm-hmm.
I think God is saying Job is never forsaken.
Yeah.
Because obviously, as a human, we still
sin. Yeah.
So it's not perfect in that sense, right, that he never sins, but it's perfect in the sense that he has never turned away from God, like David never,
yeah,
turned away from God, but Solomon did.
Yeah. Right, that he fears God, never turning away from him. There's no one like him among all of the people, and so. But yeah, it's not saying, it's not really taking up the issue of sin or blame. He's blameless is the word that gets closest to that. But in some people imagine that Job is saying, "I've never sinned," and that's not. If you read Job closely, he'll admit, like, yeah, I've, you know, he sees God like, you know, an inspector who's nitpicking at his life and hinging on to the smallest of flaws, which he admits, and making them into giving this extraordinary punishment for it. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, I had a question related to, ultimately, I'm thinking real practical,
yeah,
situations like counseling circumstances.
Right. Right.
Or whatever. And then we have all these conversations, and what I'm seeing you draw out of it is Job starts talking, and then they say, "Job, you're condemning yourself in your speech."
Mm-hmm.
And then that intensifies, maybe, or something like,
mm-hmm,
that. What can be drawn? Can anything,
yeah,
be drawn from this? You know, when people are saying, "Okay, if I'm dealing with,
yeah,
difficult circumstances and people come talk to me,
yeah,
right, do I just listen, or do I do a mixture of both?"
Yeah.
Does this happen? Do they actually,
I think,
is there a conclusion to that?
Right. I do think there is something in this for practice. I mean, on the one hand, I always want to qualify the practical use of Job with just realizing that this is such a difficult book, and in its original context probably was not used. It was not a counseling manual. But I actually just did a series of just like Facebook Live short videos with our counseling professor at HST talking about Job, and he was sort of asking, I do think there's something to, on Job's side anyway, to learning to talk in new ways after suffering and trauma and playing with new categories of understanding, taking on a new vocabulary, even then it seems unreasonable or potentially like theologically errant. You know, I do think what the friends do is they, and Job ends up accusing them of this, as defending God instead of taking his side. And sometimes as counselors, this is really hard for people who care about good theology. But sometimes there may be a place to allow somebody to speak in theologically errant ways and to not feel like you have to defend God, but to sort of just be with that person in that place. That doesn't necessarily mean silence. It might, you know, but it does mean listening and not rebuking, for not trying to correct, you know, theology in the midst of dealing through, working through suffering. So, no, go ahead.
As a suffered from chronic pain for a lot of years.
Yeah.
To pain's clinic for 5 weeks when I was learning to rewalk, learning to walk again.
Yeah.
That's one of the things that I think for my past, when I read the story, is that grief and pain are not always rational. Like,
yeah,
they're not always reasonable. People say things they don't necessarily,
mm-hmm,
believe. a friend that just loves him, man, and take that as absolute, that he's, they're in a rational mode and he's in a paid mode.
Right.
Those are not equal.
Yes, yeah.
And
right.
People do that all the time. People yeah. say something irrational at a visitation or a funeral, and it's a medical council that would call in Olivia false doctor, but they're in pain.
Yeah. Yeah, and it doesn't benefit anybody. And I think God, at least according to the book of Job, God would look poorly on a person who does that. It's really tempting, though, I think, as people who just care about helping, even people think they're helping, and I think the friends genuinely believe that they're trying to help Job by sort of bring him back to moderation and kind of remind him of the old wisdom that is sometimes right. You look at some of the things that the friends say with some of the things in the book of Proverbs, and they line up perfectly. You know, you reap what you sow, and things. These principles of wisdom are not, it's not that their wisdom is bad, it's just that their timing is bad. It's out of place. It's a word spoken unfitly. Or, so, yeah.
Is it possible that Job's friends are actually affirmed in the book in the same way that we have forgiven Job's true speech?
Yeah.
Does the book itself give any indication that, yes, they counseled him wrong,
mm-hmm.
or told, you know, it particularly, but we still affirm it? Is there anything that indicates that?
Yeah, well, I don't, Job says basically you're lying for God. You're being untrue. And because they're not recognizing the gravity of his innocence and suffering, and so I think that's right. And in the closest we get to assessing how true the friends were is at the very end of the book, when, you know, God is, after he says that to Eliphaz, he says, "Now go ask Job to intercede for you on your behalf." So basically, there God is going to punish them, but Job offers sacrifices and prays for his friends. And that is actually the last thing that he does before he is, I wouldn't say quite restored, but until his life is, he gets, God basically pays him, we'll use the word restores for now. But in any case, Job has to intercede for them because they're guilty. They're guilty of mistreating him. But it has less to do with the content of what they're saying as far as the wisdom that they're calling upon than it does, I think in the last parts of the speeches especially, really they are condemning him, and that's wrong. Writing him off as wicked. So when they moved there, then that's what their God is paying them back for.
But do you only know that the content of their theology is not necessarily condemned because some of it agrees with Proverbs, or outside the book?
Yeah.
Is there something in the book that also...
Well, I mean, when we get into God's speech, you get something different about what the Lord has to say that is not exactly what the friends have spoken, but there are also parallels. Like what the friends speak, you know, if I were you, I would entreat God. Well, that's good advice, you know? And that's ultimately what Job does. It's not, they don't want him to bring a legal case against him, but I think we, by knowing how they've, and also maybe Job is restored to a life that works according to the principles of retribution in the end, people getting what they deserve and so on. That's what the prologue, that's not a bad paradigm. And I don't think Job, a lot of times people would say Job is written in order to subvert that paradigm and to do away with any principles of people getting what, you know, reaping what they sow and so on. I don't think the book does that. It's not as radical as people want it to be in the end. But right, I think by looking outside and understanding these other authoritative texts, that especially wisdom texts, that Job should kind of fit there. It is calling some of that into question and certainly opening up a category for testing that doesn't fit retribution. Incidentally, like especially in early rabbinic interpretation of the book of Job, if they're going to interact with the dialogue, they side with the friends. as crazy as that sounds, they didn't read to the end or something. But some of the early rabbis would, you know, you read what Job is reading honestly, and you think, hey, this is God shooting me with poison arrows. He's accusing God of injustice, and there's no qualms about that. And so the a lot of early interpreters would say, well, you can't talk to God like that, and you really shouldn't talk like to God about God like this. And I think God will essentially say that, but God is gracious in the end. So not that we should side with the friends, but there have been sympathetic readers for the friends, and I think we do need to be a little bit more sympathetic than sometimes they get shown less sympathy than they deserve.
Yeah, it's
Mm-hmm.
Do we see in the book any difference between the three friends? Are they all sort of the same character, or are there?
Yeah, that's a good question. In fact, my research started with that question, trying to kind of break down, okay, is there any difference between Eliphaz and Bildad and Zophar? And it's really difficult. I haven't seen a good argument for that. They pretty much say the same thing, although they do have, like, if we were to talk about chapter 28 of Job, and there's lots of scholarly debate about who it's, I mean, within our Bibles, Job is given credit for the speech in 28, but some people think things get messed up. It sounds a lot like Zophar. So read chapter 28 as Zophar, because he uses a lot of natural imagery and so on, and you get a really different reading of that speech. Or Elihu, you get a different reading of that speech. So it's very hard to disentangle. They pretty much have the same theological perspective and the same rhetorical move from acknowledging, I mean, what they do in each of their speeches is rebuke him for the way that he's talking, and then remind him of where his hope should be, and then talk really generally about the wicked. This is what wicked people are like, and this is when they get into talking about trees or animals or something. And all three of them do that. The dialogue runs into the ground, or something happens in the third cycle of speeches where Bildad's speech is like four or five verses and Zophar never gets a third speech. So you can interpret that as the book is and say that it runs out, or there are other theories. But thematically, I don't see much difference. It's a good question, though, and one that I'm still interested in.
Would you say that after these things transpire that God would have still described Job as blameless?
It's a good question. I do think Job moves from the end of chapter 2 where the narrator is affirming what God would say, that in all of this Job did not sin with his lips. So part of the question is, does Job sin with his lips in chapter 3? And he's rebuked. He does speak theological error. But it's woven. It's hand in glove with speaking in a way that is full of integrity and honesty. And although Job, when we talk about God's speech, we can kind of think about what God is correcting, or if he is. I do think he's rebuking him, and yet more like a teacher than one who's, he doesn't have to sacrifice or offer prayers for himself, like the way the friends do. So I would say, I don't know, it depends how you define blameless, right? Without, it maybe less so. But I think he's maintained his integrity, and you can still say he's never cursed God, and I think you can still say at the end of the dialogue that he's been honest and maybe wrong, but still righteous.
All right. Well, thank you for returning for our afternoon lecture today with Lance Hawley, Dr. Lance Hawley. From Memphis. He teaches at the Harding School of Theology. Looks like most of you are probably here this morning. He did a dissertation at the University of Wisconsin in Madison on the topic of the Book of Job. And so this afternoon he will talk to us about the Yahweh speeches in the Book of Job. This morning he talked about the cycle of friend speeches. So his topic is, what kind of response does Yahweh provide? So we're looking forward to learning about that. Dr. Lance Hawley.
Thank you. So, this question of what kind of response Yahweh gives to Job is one that has driven my research in Job. At least it's kind of my first real inquiry into Job. And that's partly because of, disagreements about the content of Job or God's speech. Brueggemann characterizes the divine speeches as, quote, lordly, haughty, condescending, dismissive, reprimanding, and refusing to entertain Job's profound questions. Or question, he has many questions, but anyway, it says, quote, another scholar, calls God insecure and says, quote, he blusters and bullies Job, never effectively answering Job's questions, unquote. McKinsey says that God's speech is, quote, shaking a rattle at a crying child to divert its attention from hunger. And there are others, that basically portray God as a bully. And he shows up and he says, I'm bigger than you, and you know nothing about me, and you need to move on. And I think I don't want to totally disagree with that, but I do think that God talks for three chapters. Well, 38, 39, 40, and then the end of the dialogue, or the end of Job's response here in 41. So there's I kept on thinking, there must be something in the content, the message of God's speech, more than just putting Job in his place. The way I want to address the content of the divine speeches is to focus on just one portion of it. There's two speeches. The first half, God is describing cosmic features like clouds and the sea, features of the stars, of creation. And then the second half of the first speech, starting in chapter 38, verse 39, running all the way through chapter 39, is all about wild animals. Okay, so that's where we're going to camp out. But because it would be too big, and we can talk some about it in our discussion, but the second half of the speech is what most people think of with God's speeches, and where he talks about two super beasts, Behemoth and Leviathan. And fascinating, and God talks at length about these creatures. So what we're going to do first is talk. Well, I'll say a little bit about the first speech and how what I think God is doing in these speeches, but then look back at the dialogue to see what Job and his friends say about animals. Okay, that'll be fun, right? And they talk a lot about wild animals. But not for the purpose of talking about wild animals, or they're not biologists and they're not interested in the animals themselves, but as this is where I get into metaphor. The animals are metaphors for Job, or sometimes for the wicked. And so when a metaphor is expressed, you have a source that we're drawing from in order to talk about a target or a topic. But what those sources that we draw from demonstrate a certain shared assumptions. And Job and his friends have some shared assumptions about wild animals that God does not necessarily agree with. So I will argue that in God's speech that he subverts the way that Job and his friends see the world. And the point of God's speech is not to correct Job and his friends about, not necessarily. Well, we're going to talk about it. He's correcting their view about wild animals, but what's the point of that? So I think there's another secondary step that we'll take. When God does appear here, he shows up in a whirlwind, which is an image of power. power and potential severity. In Job chapter 9, verse 16 and 17, Job himself talks about the whirlwind, same word, and he talks about it bruising and beating him. If he were to go before God, he would use a whirlwind to beat me down. So then when God shows up in a whirlwind, the expectation on everybody's part, and maybe including ours as readers, ought to be that God is coming to bruise him, to batter him. And yet that's not, in my opinion, what we see. In the very next verse, God asks, who is this who darkens counsel? And that word etzad, or design, counsel, is a technical term, a wisdom term for giving counsel or giving design. Here I think it's used for the creative design, God's woven wisdom into the fabric of the universe. And the way that Job has talked about it is they're expressions of words without knowledge. So Yahweh is coming as a sage. This is my argument. He's coming as a teacher. If the friends, the three friends and Job, are all wisdom teachers, and they're trying to teach one another, especially the friends to Job, and they've done an insufficient job, and really the only one who can address Job is God. And when he does, he teaches them, and he comes to rebuke. He is no therapist in these speeches, right? The whirlwind, I think, is a signifier that there is a harshness to what God will say. And there's a correction, correcting Job for darkening counsel. So Yahweh does rebuke, but it, in my view, is not to be imagined as battle or defeat, like some of these quotes make God sound, in order to coming as a divine warrior to put Job down. But rather as a teacher, to instruct and to authoritatively tell Job, give him a better picture of divine design. That's essentially what we see in the divine speeches. The other clue, I think, to this Yahweh as a sage is that he's asking questions. Right, all of these rhetorical questions, one after another. Who were you? Were you there? And Job knows the answers to these questions. They're rhetorical, of course. And Job, even if you read the dialogue closely, would admit that, you know, God is bigger. God can do what he wants. So there's really nothing new about his own place. Job has not said, I am God. And God is not saying, you think you're God, but here I am. But there is something to a rhetorical question that is, I think, a pedagogical method. That when you ask a rhetorical question, just telling somebody a fact, then you're inviting them, you're eliciting knowledge, you're inviting them to kind of draw their own conclusions. And it seems to me that that's what God is doing to Job, to get him to think on God's character and the images themselves that he puts in front of them. So Yahweh does rebuke, but it's not battle or defeat, it's instruction. That is both instruction, real instruction, is both painful and constructive. And so this is why I would disagree with all three quotes that I read earlier. God is not just, in my view, blowing Job off or oppressing him further, but is trying to construct something new for him, trying to give him an experience that does instruct, that does teach. So the way that we're going to try to get a view of that is by looking at these wild animal pictures. So this is in, like I said, starting in Job 38, 39, and going all the way through chapter 39. And so before we get to the speech itself, let me just give you a little bit of an idea of what we have about animals in the dialogue. The longest chapter of my dissertation is on animals in the dialogue, 120 pages on these animals, and just close readings of these texts. And I love it. I love, I have this sense of humor. I don't know if you share this sense of humor with me, like talking animals are hilarious to me, or, you know, talking babies, or, you know, anyway. That's not really why I love the book of Job. but the biology or the, I guess, the zoology in these dialogues is pretty fascinating. But more importantly, I think they tell us something about how the characters view their world. So in chapter 6, in Job's first real speech, I mean, chapter 3 is a monologue, and the official dialogue begins with Eliphaz responding. So you don't ever have a dialogue until you have a response. So when Job now in chapter 6 is responding to Eliphaz, he describes the way he's being treated in verse 4. This is after that quote about having rash words. He says, "For the arrows of the Almighty," that's El Shaddai, "are in me. My spirit drinks their poison. The terrors of God are arrayed against me." So God is hunting him like a divine warrior. He's coming after him, shooting him with arrows, poison arrows, terrorizing him. Job regularly portrays himself as the enemy of God. And the friends will say, "You're speaking like this," and he'll say, "Yeah, I am that. I'm being treated like God's enemy, and God is the divine warrior against the enemy." There's not an animal image here, but we have this kind of, unless he's a hunted animal with the poison arrows or something. In chapter 7, verse 12, and this would deal more in the realm of the behemoth or Leviathan, but in chapter 7, verse 12, he questions. He says, "I won't restrain my mouth." In verse 11, he says, and then he questions, "Am I the sea or the dragons?" The word here is tanin. So it's like the sea dragon or sea monster or something. And the sea is this personified power of chaos. "Am I the sea or the dragon that you set a guard over me?" So he imagines himself as being imprisoned, like God imprisons the sea, or God imprisons the dragon. They're the sea monster. And he's questioning it here, right? This is how he's being treated. So he likens himself to these beasts of entities of chaos that God subdues. And then in chapter 16, these are all kind of prior to, just to give you some idea of how he's imagining himself to be like entities that are destructive or God's enemies. In chapter 16, verse 12 and following, "I was at ease and he broke me in two." This is some of the harshest the harshest description of what his own situation. "But I was at ease. He broke me in two. He seized me by the neck and dashed me to pieces. He set me up as his target. His archers surround me. He slashes open my kidneys and shows no mercy. He pours out my gall on the ground. He bursts upon me again and again, and he rushes at me like a warrior." So clearly he's viewing God in two related images, one as the divine warrior, but also as the divine hunter. And these two go together, even in ancient Near Eastern practices where, you know, the king of Mesopotamia, in order to show his rule over those powers of chaos, would have a hunt. And they would Tiglath-Pileser and others have pictures of them hunting wild animals in order to show that they can overcome the beasts of chaos. They have control, the world domination. And Job then uses those same kind of images to talk about how he's being treated by the divine warrior or the divine hunter. One more. In chapter 19, verse 11 through 12, he says, "He has kindled his wrath against me, and he counts me as his enemy. His troops come together. They have thrown up siege works against me in a camp around my tent." So again, these are not necessarily animal metaphors, but certainly great text to show how Job feels, that he's being treated like God treats the wicked, like God treats the enemies, hunted and having war imposed upon him. Okay, so then if we go back and look at animals for specifically, we have one important one that I mentioned earlier with Eliphaz in chapter 4. verses 10 and 11, and I read this earlier with the lion, the roar of a lion. And I've translated all of these as lion, but they're all different Hebrew words. And there is an adult lion and a young lion, but beyond that, we have a hard time saying what they are. In any case, it's about the roar and the sound of the lion, the teeth of young lions. But what happens in this scenario is God, I think is implied, pulls out or breaks the teeth of young lions. That would be an unnatural feature. Old lions get broken teeth, but young lions would not. The lion perishes for lack of prey, and the cubs of the lion are scattered. So this is a trope or an image for Eliphaz to say to Job, God punishes the wicked. Now, when he talks about the roar, maybe I mentioned this earlier, but Job himself has used that word for his own condition. And I think Eliphaz activates a lion metaphor here in saying, even if Job didn't mean it that way, he's saying, you know, you're talking like the wicked. That goes back to what we were saying. But the lion is a symbol for the wicked. Not in every biblical text, but consistently in Job and in many other biblical texts, an animal that God breaks the teeth of. So a symbol for God's punishment of the wicked. And wicked people then are imagined to be predatory animals that rightly suffer for their unjust acts. So, the second lion metaphor, and bear with me if this is, you're not into the lion metaphors and things, because I think this really does matter for understanding God's speech, is in chapter 10, verse 16, and this time in Job's mouth. And there's two different ways to take this. I think the best way is that Job is the lion and God is the hunter. NRSV's translation is, bold as a lion, you hunt me, you repeat your exploits against me. Just prior to this, if I am wicked, so this is verse 15, woe to me, but if I'm righteous, I cannot lift up my head. So even if I'm righteous, I can't lift up my head. For if I'm filled with disgrace and look upon my affliction, and then we get this lion metaphor, where Job is saying, I am a lion, and I think this corresponds with the lifting up of the head. The other way to take it would be God himself being the lion, and some would argue for that. But I think it works best as, and God does appear as a lion in chapter 16, so it's not totally unreasonable. But here God, I think, is portrayed as a lion hunter, and Job as the enemy of God, as the lion. You have all of this corresponding with other language about like God's watch, God's oppressive watch, guarding it like a prisoner, and so on. In chapter 13, Job takes on the image of a predatory animal. In verse 14, he says, I will take my teeth in my flesh in my teeth. I mentioned that one earlier. So he's sort of this self-predatory animal. And then Bildad speaks up and refers to this in chapter 18, verse 4, and describing Job as one who tears himself in anger. In English, these may not be it's so clear that these are animal metaphors, but there's language in here like the word for tear that's used for like a carcass of an animal, or you tear it apart, or anytime you have breaking of teeth in the Bible, it's almost always an animal metaphor, often associated with lions. In chapter 19, verse 6, Job says, know that God has wronged me, and his net has enclosed me. In chapter 18, Bildad has this extended trap metaphor, and he just like lists every different type of trap that you have. And the trap scenario is really common in wisdom literature for describing intrinsic retribution. In other words, people walking themselves and walk into their own traps. And it takes out the agency of retribution from God, God punishing from the outside in order to put the blame more on the sinner themselves, right? So traps work really well for that, especially bird traps, where the trap is laid out there, but then with, you know, the person or the bird is not walking, and all of a sudden he falls into a trap, or the nets come over him, or so on. So this could be in chapter 19, and I think referring to that, but giving agency to God. In other words, Job is saying, it's God who's wronged me. It's his net that's been put over me. So don't just try to pin this on me. God's done this to me. And the friends are regularly using this scenario for intrinsic retribution and in other metaphors and other other descriptions. And Job resists it at every turn. It is not himself. But again, elaborating hunter with God. So God's the hunter. Chapter, finally, for the predatory animals anyways, in chapter 29, when Job is talking about his past life and his acts of justice, he says, I broke the jaws of the wicked. I made him drop his teeth, or his prey from his teeth. So Job is a shepherd, and the wicked person is a predatory animal. So it's not that Job has a problem with the metaphor, right? Yeah, wicked people are predatory animals. Everybody knows that. But Job has a problem with this being applied to him. In fact, he would say he was the one who broke the teeth of the predatory animal. He is the shepherd. And so he doesn't want... Sometimes he takes on the image of the enemy, in order, whether that's to, you know, confront God with this, look how you're treating me, or to just recognize his experience. But then he'll also... He doesn't really... This is, I think... an important point, that he really doesn't disagree with the friends a whole lot. He just disagrees about his situation and how he's being treated. Okay, so there's one major category of wild animal. And domestic animals, by the way, come up a little bit, but mostly in the prologue when they're just talking about Job's possessions. In chapter 6, verse 5, he'll say, am I the wild donkey, that I should, without food, basically, without bring, or, do, you know, is there, and he'll use the domestic ox in the same verse. But basically, his point there is, I have good reason to complain. And so he likens himself to these other animals. But the other major category of wild animals in the dialogue is the desert animals, okay? Those that don't necessarily prey on any others, but they don't offer anything to people. They're undomesticated, and the quintessential desert animal for animal lacking domestication is the wild donkey. So Job has some things to say about the wild donkey. Incidentally, these two go together in other wisdom texts, Mesopotamian wisdom texts. The lion and the donkey are paired in the dialogue of pessimism, which is a Mesopotamian story. So these two animals are regular features in wisdom dialogues. They appear, as I said, the wild donkey appears in 6:5, and then two long texts where in chapter 24, verse 4 through 8, Job says, he's talking about the poor who have been pushed from the road, and he's in verse 5, he says they are wild donkeys in the steppe. They're soaked by rains, without shelter, they embrace the rocks. People would just see the metaphor just in this one line, but I think 4 through 8 are other features of wild donkey life. They are symbols of marginalization. They have domestic donkeys, okay? And there's a different word for the wild donkey or the onager. They live out in the desert. They eat. They're known for eating just scrub that nobody else would eat. And so they become symbols of poverty or marginalization, or they're pitied, essentially. Job, therefore, can use them to talk about the way the poor are being treated, those who are cast out. And also in chapter 30, verse 1 through 8, there is a... Let me just read this. And I don't, maybe see if you hear the wild donkey metaphor here. He's talking... This is the turn. So in chapter 29, he's talked about those who are younger than him, It used to be that when he would stand up to teach, they would all be silent. They would listen, because if Job was there, they better listen to him. He was the authority. He was respected. They would cover their mouth in his presence. But now, so begins chapter 30, they, I think those younger than him, they make sport of me, those who are younger than I, whose fathers I would have disdained to set with the dogs of my flock. And then, what could I gain from the strength of their hands? All the vigor is gone. And then I would say 3 through 8 is a collage of desert animals, and one of those animals is the wild donkey. Through want and hard hunger, they gnaw the dry ground and desolate ground. They pick mallow and leaves from the bushes. This next line, the NRSV has that they warm themselves, but it's the word for eating, or bread. If you point it a different way, it becomes a word for warming. The roots of the broom. So people don't eat broom roots. They're poisonous. So I got into all this interesting research on broom roots. And I found out that by talking to some South African zoologists that donkeys might eat a broom root. So these are things that desert animals do. They're driven out from society. People shout after them as the thief. In the gullies and the wadis, they must live in the holes in the ground. Now, donkeys don't do that. And in the rocks, among the bushes, they bray. It's just like our English word bray. I don't think we have other animals that bray besides horses or donkeys. They don't either. I might be wrong about that. If you're an expert in this area, you can tell me. Under the nettles, they huddle together. A senseless, disreputable brood, they have been whipped out of the land. They are lowlifes and no names. And Job's point is not to say that all of the people who make fun of him live out in the desert. The point is to say they're just despicable wild donkeys, or maybe they're jackals. Like these desert animals, they don't offer anything to domestic life, and so they're not valued. And they're used as images of despair. And even Job makes this point obvious with a couple of these animals. And at the end of chapter 30, where he says, I am the brother of jackals and the companion of ostriches. These two animals are also paired in Micah 1:8, as symbols of lament. So Job is a lamenter. He's like a desert lamenter. But if his only company are... or if his company are these desert animals, then he's basically saying, I am totally marginalized, and you should feel sorry for me because of that. You should hear my lament. And he goes on to talk about his skin turning black and falling from him. So, all of these express Job is a wild animal, and none of them are, that's never a positive metaphor for Job in the dialogue. And he protests this, and he laments this, and sometimes he takes it on as a way of projecting his enemy status, marginalization, and lack of divine concern for his state of being. So the assumption is that God doesn't care about these things either. God doesn't care about him, therefore he can be likened to a wild animal. So all of that, I think, is important for understanding God's speech. Because when we turn to Yahweh's speech in chapter 38, as I said, the first portion of this is about the cosmos and different features of, especially the created world, the foundations of the earth. Notice in verse 8, God's description of the sea. Who shut in the sea with doors when it bursts forth from the womb? When I made the clouds its garments and thick darkness its swaddling band, and prescribed bounds for it, and set bars and doors, and said, thus far you shall come, and no farther. And here shall your profound waves be stopped. So if we think about this verse in relation to chapter 7, verse 12, when Job says, am I the sea or the sea dragon that you imprison me? There's a parallel. God does put boundaries on the sea. But when God describes it, he describes the sea as a baby that he's swaddling in cloths. So the boundaries are not the prison, this chaotic enemy of God to be imprisoned and done and put down, but one that he cares about. They're proud, you know, he's excited about the sea. Yes, he puts limits on it, but his perspective on the sea is different than that Job has. And this is what we'll see with the animals too, that essentially God is reframing the created universe as a way of putting right Job's view of divine counsel, divine design. He has darkened it, and now God is correcting that. And then perhaps secondarily, I think there is a message for Job himself, although this speech ignores people. It's a lot like Psalm 104. If you go read Psalm 104, a lot of these images and Genesis 1, it's kind of God's good creation. But in Psalm 104, people play a part in it. In Job 38 through 40, people are not there. And even when we'll get to the wild donkey part, we'll see that. And in verse 26 of chapter 38, he's talking about the desert channels. Who cut a channel for the torrents of the rain and the way for the thunderbolt to bring land to bring rain on a land where no person, no one lives? So God cares about the things that people don't. Those desert lands, those desert entities on the desert, which is empty of human life. But he satisfies it. He takes care of it. God is not a divine warrior. He is a wildlife manager. So we get then views of, we get little pericopes starting in chapter 38, 39. The lion, the raven, the mountain goat, the deer, the wild donkey, and the ox, the sand grouse, or maybe the ostrich, but I think it's a sand grouse, the horse, hawk, and vulture, which happens to prey on people, and the slain bodies of war. So two of these definitely relate to the images that we've seen before, the lion and the wild donkey. My bigger point will be not that Job wants us to recall, oh, remember back when Eliphaz said in chapter 4, verse 10 through 11, how he was talking about lions? Well, I have something to say about that. I don't think that happens. And what reader of Job says, oh, I remember when Eliphaz was talking about this? Or I remember in chapter 10, verse 16, when you likened yourself to a lion? But kind of on a bigger picture, he's reframing the way that Job sees himself and these images of the wild. So in the lion, do you hunt prey for the lion? The implication here, I think, of all of these is that God does. So he doesn't hunt the lion, he hunts the lion's prey. And even more, it's for the young lions, or satisfy the appetite of the young lions while they crouch down in dens and sit in their thicket of their lair. So the lion is not God's enemy. The lion predation is not punishment, or punished with starvation. In other words, the whole schema of retribution doesn't apply to the lion. Job's point is that God is treating him like the enemy lion, and God responds by saying that the lion is not his enemy, God's enemy. So he's not necessarily telling Job, you're not my enemy, but he is, I think, sort of undercutting that whole argument that he's his enemy. Incidentally, there's a word, I think a word play on Job's name. In Hebrew, it's Eov, and the same consonants, if you point different ways, then you can get Oyev, which is enemy. So it seems like there's something bigger going on in the book where Job is recognizing himself as the enemy, and God is essentially saying, you are not my enemy. He's not necessarily, he's not explaining his suffering. He's not answering all of his questions, but he is giving him a really roundabout way of saying, I care for you. we have the raven. God also feeds the raven. So there's feeding in the lion and the raven and the mountain goat and the deer. It's about birthing and rearing children, watching over them. Maybe a counter image of, these are not domestic sheep. These are not goats. Maybe Job knows about the gestation period of the mountain goat, but he doesn't care. They don't do him any good. And Job's world is all about him, as it is for most people. If you read Job's description in chapter 29, the world revolves around him in concentric circles, and at the very margin of this is those wild things and the wicked, and all they're all associated with, and Job and God is sort of doing away with that framing of his own life. We get to the wild donkey then, after the deer, and it says, "Who has set the wild donkey free, or loosed the fetters of the onager, for which I have made a habitat in the desert plain and the dwelling place in their salt lands?" So these are uninhabitable places for people, but just right for the wild donkey. He laughs at the commotion of the city. Actually, several of these animals are laughing. The horse will laugh. The sand grouse will laugh. But what he's laughing at is he's making fun of those city dwellers, those people in the city. He doesn't obey the shouts of the driver. He searches the mountains for his grazing land and seeks every green thing. So there is no destitution here. Even though from a human perspective, these animals are to be pitied. They're just like starving out in their desert. And God is saying, no, you know, I provided those broom roots or whatever just for them. I take care of them. They may not do you any good. They don't have any utilitarian purpose for you, but they're still good. Newsom, she writes about, in her part on writing, or in her commentary on this, she says, "Its habitat," talking about the wild donkey, "the desolate salt flats and nearly barren mountains, is not only the opposite of human sown land, but also serves as an image of punishment for people. By contrast, the city, the quintessential place of human culture, is presented as a locus of noise and oppression, a place of bondage from which God sets the wild ass free." So anyway, you see this shifting of perspective that's going on here. Yahweh's, I'll just read this to you, cause this is some of my favorite lines. Maybe not. Yahweh's positive assessment of the wild donkey says nothing about impoverished people. And I think that's important. Like, he doesn't say you should think about impoverished people here, but he says it does shift the ground, or I say it does shift the ground, on which Job has construed his suffering. So the way that he's framing his own suffering is through these images, and God is pulling the rug out from under that. Job darkens divine design by calling his mockers asses. And Yahweh calls him on it, not because he sides with the mockers against Job. It's not like he's saying, you know, I'm on the side of the mockers, or disagrees with Job about mean-spirited people, but because he cares about the ass. Like, he's just like, don't talk bad about my wild donkey. And that may seem sort of peripheral. And I think it has seemed very peripheral to a lot of interpreters. However, when taken in, I think we need to think about what that does for somebody who's suffering and what's that also saying about Job's own situation. So Yahweh's corrective serves to reorient Job to the divine perspective on the wild world of the onager. We also have the wild ox, and the description there is about non-domestication and strength. The sand grouse, I think every translation I have has ostrich, but it's a little bit different word. We won't get into this very much. It doesn't really matter that much, I don't think, except the only image. I think it's a small bird that's actually God. The line is that God does not give it wisdom. I think God keeps, the sign of wisdom is fear and caution. And this bird has no caution. This bird has no caution because if it did, it would abandon its eggs on the ground. So it takes a lack of fear, which is a symbol of a lack of wisdom, to sit on your eggs in spite of a horse coming to trample you. And that seems to be the image here. And the war horse also is fearless, and it also laughs. And then the final two images are of birds of predation, hawk and the vulture, or maybe the eagle. But they scavenge on the blood of slain humans. It's God's way of caring for them. So I'm going to draw some conclusions, and then we'll talk about it together a little bit. So Yahweh doesn't group the wild animals with the wicked or show them to have enemy status, and this is the major point of contrast in the conceptualization of the wild animals in Job's expressions. And second, then, in cognitive terms, I think I'll explain this after I say it, but Yahweh profiles wild animals against the domain of divine care instead of the domain divine punishment. So if Job is a wild animal throughout the dialogue, and then God frames what it means to be a wild animal in the framework of divine care, essentially then Job, even in a as a person who's destitute and suffering, is framed within the framework of divine care. Yahweh doesn't speak metaphors, he speaks literally about animals. But the features of creation that Job and his friends assume to be destructive and useless are what he reframes. In a sense, Yahweh undercuts Job's source domain for construing enemy. So he takes away the ground for how he understands enemy. It's not that the divine speeches necessarily expect readers to recall expressions, and I said this earlier, of wild animals, but that Yahweh's animal images cohere on a basic level. Okay, so then the third part of this, coherence is evident, and this is kind of a bigger topic of, is God responding to anything in the dialogue? I think my answer is yes. He's responding to their images. So he's not just blowing them off or ignoring everything that came before. So it does cohere, and I think this is evident. Especially with the lions and the wild donkeys on this basic level. So Yahweh doesn't subvert the principle of retribution. In fact, a couple of places in the speech he'll talk about the wicked and shaking them out. So God, he still has a category. It's not as though God is amoral or he throws retribution to the wind. He still has a category for the wicked and the punishment of the wicked. But he does question the metaphors that Job uses to imagine divine punishment. So, I believe that Job is newly equipped to understand not only the world of the wilderness, but also reframe his own suffering. It doesn't give him answers, but I think it does give him perspective. So yes, Job is like the lion, and like the marginalized ass, like the sea monster, but no, he's not Yahweh's enemy. There's no explanation for Job's suffering in these images. But there's a recategorization so that Job might know that he belongs among the beloved creatures of God. There's the point. So, I mean, it's kind of a roundabout way of getting at this, but I think the only way to understand, you know, the point of God's speeches is to look at the images themselves. And what is very unique about the images is the way that God talks about these symbols of wickedness or despair, marginalization, and God does not do battle with them. Even Leviathan, he takes pride in his power, and yeah, he has control over him, but he is not the seven-headed beast that God destroys, you know, or does bad. God's not a divine warrior, he's a wildlife manager. And so then we have to think, well, how does that communicate to somebody who's suffering? I guess on the counseling side of things, I do think I've been wondering whether I'll tell like one anecdotal story here, and then we'll have conversation. But I have a friend who lost her husband and blogged the year after losing her husband. And in one of her blogs, it was just about her dog, watching her dog play and sort of enjoy life. He doesn't know what's going on in my life as far as my inner turmoil, but man, it's so good for me to watch my dog play. And I was studying this and thinking about this all the same at the same time, and I was thinking, yeah, I wonder, you know, for somebody who's endured suffering or trauma, and you know, you're not going to get answers. Job doesn't help you diagnose. Sometimes we can diagnose, like people get what they sow and deserve, and it's kind of obvious. But a lot of times it doesn't help us diagnose, can't put our finger on why. But I wonder how good it would be for somebody undergoing trauma or suffering to like binge watch Planet Earth Like, just spend 6 hours watching the wild world that cares nothing about you. And it's not as a diversion, not a shaking rattle in order to take your mind off of the suffering, but as a way of sort of reframing the world, seeing the largeness of the world and God's care for the minutia that has nothing to do with you. And I really don't think God is ignoring Job. In fact, he's addressing Job. I mean, this experience of being, hearing God speak is totally unique. This is the longest speech of God in the Bible. And so he is addressing him, and I think we need to think about how these images matter to somebody who's suffering. And in my limited experience, I do think going for a walk in the woods, observing the mosquito or whatever it is, you know, observing the little ant that you step on usually or whatever, you know, we might learn something about God's care for us, or at least reframe our own experiences, human experiences, by seeing the margins of the created universe. So that's what I have. I'm interested in any of your comments or questions. Yeah, Jeremy. Okay. Yeah.
As God the warrior. How do you
right.
Everybody doesn't have to communicate the same image.
Yeah.
Understand that. How does that fit with some of the other passages of scripture?
Yeah.
Is there any conflict, or is it kind of like,
right,
no, these are just multiple images?
Well, there are multiple images in Psalms, certain, like Psalm 74 or Habakkuk 3 or something, have God as fully as a divine warrior. And sometimes in relation to I think Isaiah 51 with Leviathan and God crushing Leviathan, and Job 3 has that understanding. And I think we have within the book of Job, you have a counter image to that in God's speech. Within the canon, you have certain creation narratives that line up, I think, better with Job 38 and God's speech, like I mentioned Genesis 1 and Psalm 104. But you certainly have other creation narratives that are more like the divine warrior defeating the powers of chaos. And I think, I imagine in ancient Israel, you pick one to make your point. You know, they have both narratives of and depictions. And so to say that maybe what Job needed to hear is that God is a wildlife manager, or, you know, this sort of softer view of how God views creation instead of the divine warrior. I actually think this is kind of new for Job, within the story of Job. It's like, oh, you were a different God than I thought you were. So it is reframing God for Job. But within the Bible, yeah, they're not always in conflict. Mark Smith has a great book on Genesis 1 where he kind of goes through these different creation streams. And certainly in the Psalms, you see different ones. Yeah, good question. Yeah.
In the wrap up.
Yeah.
It's kind of interesting. I'd love to hear your.
Yeah.
There's somebody that is conspicuously absent from the wrap up.
Yeah.
Why is there nothing about Satan?
Oh, I thought you were going to say Elihu.
Kind of marginalized.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, and I should also just mention that the end, Job's response to the divine speeches in chapter 42, verses 1 through 6, is really ambiguous and difficult. He submits, I think recognizes teaching, and he does have this really important line that he admits, I've uttered things too wonderful for me, which I didn't know. He says, I had heard of you by the hearing of the ear, and now my eye sees you. So he's had a new encounter with God in this vision. And then whatever comes next, that's difficult. But either way, he decides to be done with this stage of things and submit. He does admit that he's spoken out of turn. He's spoken incorrectly, spoken things that I didn't understand. So I think there is repentance in that sense. And then after that, we get back into the prologue and the narrative, and we talked about Eliphaz and the friends and the intercession that goes on there. If we're going back to the issue of the Satan, and why not always put the in front of Satan in this? Because in Hebrew it has the definite article, so it's a title. It's not a name. It's not a proper noun. And I think the title for the book of Job, anyway, he appears as one, as a worker of within God's court, who brings accusation. He's the eyes and ears of God, essentially to find flaws in people in order to bring them to court before God. Of course, in the prologue, it's God who says, "Hey, have you considered my servant Job?" And then I think he serves within the book, he serves as a literary character to pose the question, to get things going. Much in the same way, we can talk more about this, but it's to pose the question within the heavenly dialogue. The question gets posed, or the temptation, will Job curse God with his lips, gets posed, put into the mouth of his wife in the dialogue, and within the outside, on the earth. You know, so you have this heavenly dialogue and this earthly dialogue, and they mirror each other. And don't think evil, we should think of the Satan in Job anyway as the taking on the full character of Satan, capital S, no the, that we have later, certainly in the kind of the developed theology of ancient Israel. So I don't think he comes back in the end, because he was a setup character, there's no punishment that's necessary for, he's doing his job. And maybe he was, it's interesting because God is responsible for the suffering of Job. I don't think there's any doubting that, but God does give Job into the hand of the accuser. God is ultimately culpable for it. So it's not as though he's rebelled against God and taken suffering and made Job to suffer. So it's hard to say why somebody's not there, but I think he's not there because it's not important to explain the repercussion, any repercussions for him. Yeah, that may, there's lots of questions. When I teach Job in churches, or even in classes, we hang out on the Satan character for a while, because this is one of the earliest reference to within the biblical canon to it, and you do have a progression, I think, of an understanding of who that character is. Good. Other questions? Yeah, Jeremy.
Let me give you a fun one.
Okay. Yeah.
The conversation in heaven, the conversation on earth.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, you mean the... Yeah, I would want to say that the wife is no more... I think she's also a... Not to say that she's not... Either of these characters aren't real characters or whatever, but think within the context of the book, they're set-up characters, right? It's in order to pose the question. This is a philosophical wisdom book that we should read... as one that's it's written in order to ask questions, to wrestle with questions, and so on. And these characters serve the purpose of promoting. So, like, what if, to really put the test out there? Will you curse Job? Will you curse God? And so the wife serves that same purpose as the Satan character does. But please hear me clearly. I'm not saying that the wife is Satan, okay? And please hear me. In fact, it's interesting, like in the Septuagint, they have an extended, they bring the wife back in a more full sense in the end. But they also have her like running from town to town looking for food. She's also a sufferer. And they really build her character up more than the Hebrew version of it, because they're interested in the same things that everybody else asks. What about the wife? You know, she gets a bad rap, and I'm sympathetic with that. But within our biblical book that we have, in the Hebrew version, it's just, she's not that important. I mean, we care about her because we care about people. But there's an interesting tradition of interpretation with her. Yeah.
One other follow-up. Is there much conversation about the feminine in the book of Job in terms of these metaphors and images of the animals? Are the animals presented neutrally?
Yeah. I haven't thought about that. I mean, like lions, there's probably male and female lions and so on. And I don't think they're overtly masculine or feminine. You have like male and female donkeys, domestic donkeys in the beginning and things, but they don't, I would say that would be a peripheral type of thing. I don't, it's not an issue for that's being taken up. Good. Any other comments or questions? Okay. Of Job?
Yeah,
so James is our reference to Job, and he refers to the patience of Job. And he would be right in line with early Christian interpreters, later Christian interpreters than James, but in generally, and Second Temple Jewish interpretation of Job, where they either they fixate on the prologue, and I mean the prologue is the story that gets told, and so the association of patience with Job, and I guess you could think about even through the dialogue of Job being patient because he's enduring and he's persisting in spite of not having answers and so on. But I think James is mostly picking up on the initial faithfulness and patience of Job in the prologue. Although patience, you know, is something that's expressed throughout the book. Christians love Job early Christian interpretation because Job isn't an Israelite. And yet he's the most blameless guy in the world. And Jews had this debate about Job. This is kind of getting sidetracked a little bit, but because whether he was before, they date him, you know, how he dates compared to Abraham. So who's more blameless, Abraham or Job, and these things. And if they're going to ridicule Job, then they go to the dialogue. If they're going to take Job's side up and support him, then they say he's a Gentile, but he's before Abraham, and they go to the prologue. So people find what they want in the book. James certainly picks up on the kind of the character and the faithfulness of Job. That's mostly expressed, I think, in the narrative portions.
You know, the Septuagint is quite a bit different from the Hebrew version.
Yeah.
You mentioned the Bella character of the lion.
Mm-hmm.
Is perhaps the patience of Job, is his rhetoric softened in the Septuagint?
That's a good question. I'm not sure. I mean, the Septuagint of Job is a real translation, it leaves verses out, and in my view, as somebody who doesn't deal with it enough to get a feel for what it's doing, it's just a mess. But I do think they do soften Job up some throughout, and I can't think of any specific examples of how they do that, but make him, I mean, he says things that you shouldn't say about God. So for all interpreters, ancient and modern, have tried to kind of ease the pain a little bit, and so the Septuagint seems to be doing that. But
I wonder if James is reading the Septuagint,
right,
more easily come to the conclusion of Job's patience.
Yeah. Do you think James read the Septuagint, or do you think James knew Hebrew?
No comment.
Why?
I was kind of worried.
James is written in Greek, I would say that.
Well, yeah, that's true.
I mean, I realize that we're talking about things where we know so little about what James knew,
Yeah.
It has nothing to do with the book we have.
Right.
So there's just a little story about a guy who lost everything.
Yeah.
Really patient, and God makes it.
Right. If you're going to maybe take what you've read and then like go tell other people about it in 2 minutes or something, you pretty much skip over everything in the dialogue. You might mention it, but the real narrative progression of the book is in the first two chapters and the last chapter. And there are events that take place in the dialogue, but you don't rehearse. I kind of doubt that the dialogue was rehearsed even in the early church. Or the early synagogues and things. It's such a hard book in the first place to read and understand. And that may have happened on occasion, but I think the way that the story was probably more likely known was just by kind of sharing, knowing the gist of the story and sharing the highlights. And the dialogue could be part of that, but you maybe don't have God shooting Job with poison arrows. Maybe you do, I don't know. It's hard to say. It's hard to say, but that's my impression, that there is a narrative that agrees with the book, but it kind of sort of sums it up. And what you get when you sum up Job is a patient character, a faithful character, somebody who passes the test, submits, and is restored, or is, I think God pays reparations for the injustice that he does toward Job. And you don't replace kids, right? So we can all acknowledge that it's not a perfect restoration, but he pays him twice what he had before. It's what you do in biblical law, like if you steal from somebody, then you pay twice. I think God recognizes an injustice that was done to Job, and he's doing the only thing he can do to try to pay back. Good. Well, thank you so much for your questions, and it's been a great honor and real joy to be with you.
We appreciate you being with us, Dr. Hawley, and thank you for your attendance at this year's lectures. And a reminder that I think the next thing coming up on our campus is the COIL Colloquium in April, on a Friday in April. And I think it's D.A. Carson this year. So make plans for that. And thank you for being here.